all of what we do today stems from really the vision of our founder, Isaiah Thomas. And our speaker this evening, Peter S. Onuf, is one of the leading authorities on another Thomas, Thomas Jefferson. Peter S. Onuf is the Thomas Jefferson Memorial Foundation Professor of History Emeritus at the University of Virginia. He retired in 2012 after teaching at the University of Virginia for more than 20 years. Dr. Onuf is also a senior fellow at Monticello's Robert H. Smith International Center for Jefferson Studies. Professor Onuf is the author, co-author, and editor of numerous books, most notably as author, Jefferson's Empire, The Language of American Nationhood, The Mind of Thomas Jefferson, and as editor, Jeffersonian Legacies. Dr. Onuf has also written extensively on sectionalism, federalism, and political economy. With his brother, political theorist Nicholas G. Onuf, he collaborated on Nations, Markets, and War, Modern History in the American Civil War, A History of International Law and Order in the Atlantic States during the Age of Revolutions in the early 19th century. He was also a co-host with Brian Baylow and Edward Ayers of the weekly public radio program and podcast Backstory with the American History Guides. Peter was elected a member of the American Antiquarian Society in October of 1994. During this academic year, Dr. Onuf is serving as the A.S. Mellon Distinguished Scholar in Residence at the American Antiquarian Society. This appointment is funded by a grant to AS from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, which makes it possible for us to annually invite a highly distinguished senior scholar to take up long-term residence at the Society to do research and writing on a major research project and to engage fully in the collegial life of the Society and to serve as an anchor for the AS Fellowship Program as a whole and especially as a mentor younger scholars in residence. Professor Onuf has fulfilled these obligations brilliantly. He is a kind, generous, insightful, and wise counselor to all of the other fellows, experienced and junior alike. And as we will hear, he has paid further service to the Society by concentrating his research energies while in residence on our founder, Isaiah Thomas, and the early years of the Society's history. Please join me in welcoming Peter S. Onuf.
Thanks, Jim. I've been looking forward to this for months, and this is it. So my future, entire future depends on how you react to it. You feel any pressure? It is a great, great privilege to be here and to have been here and to spend some more time here working both for the wonderful people who run this organization and the brilliant young people who keep streaming in. Everybody's young now that I've reached to my 70s. And it's not wonderful to be in your 70s. Now I guess some negative folks. Maybe it's that I'm on my way to becoming an antique myself that made me interested in the whole idea of antiquarian. Actually, to be totally honest with you, I didn't know what I'd do here because I thought I was safely out to pasture after my distinguished career as a Jefferson Scholar. I had to come back in and do something. And so, as I told my friends here at our first meeting, I'm here to pander to you. I will study you. But it turns out to be a really interesting subject for me to try to understand what that vision was that Jim just mentioned. What could it possibly mean to be an antiquarian in 1812 when Isaiah Thomas called himself an antiquary, a very strange thing to do, as I'll explain, and invited other people to sign up and to be antiquaries with him. Now, here's the short version of what I want to say. If I succeed tonight, I will be very inspirational, because I want you to see how antiquarianism can be the pathway to the redemption of the Republic. It's a modest goal. Some of you may have had redemption on your mind, but I think there is some wisdom in what Thomas tried to do. And it's a wisdom that's very hard for us to discern now because of subsequent developments in the history of the society and in the very idea of antiquarianism. And just to get this out in front and off to the side, let's talk about the caricature of the antiquary for just a minute. I made myself read part of a novel by Walter Scott, and I truly hate Walter Scott. I couldn't have said that earlier this year when we had a fellow from France working on Sir Walter Scott. But he wrote a book called The Antiquary that was published shortly after the founding of the society in 1816. It was published after 1812 as the founding year of this great organization. And Jonathan Oldbuck is the titular character, the antiquary. And you will not be surprised to hear that he's an eccentric. He has a passion for absolutely worthless knowledge. He collects things without a clue to what they might mean. And he's made a laughingstock every time he runs into somebody in his neighborhood, who, and they all know a lot more about the history of this place than he does. This idea of an eccentric doing worthless study of stupid subjects and collecting old, worthless things. Well, now we know that some of these old, worthless things are actually worth quite a bit, but it was something you could laugh at. And the character Oldbuck is not a very important one in the book, and he disappears because there's a typical Scott romance, at which time I close the book. Actually, I don't read books anymore. It was my Kindle. I just gotta be completely honest. They don't collect Kindles here, so they're really out of it. Anyway, the antiquary, just keep that idea in your mind as I try to tell you that an antiquary in Thomas's vision was a true patriot who was responding to the needs of the Republic in a moment of danger. How could antiquarianism be patriotism? That might be my rhetorical question. And let's begin by bringing Isaiah Thomas into conversation with the return of the repressed, Thomas Jefferson. I can't get rid of him. But I want to talk about the two Thomases for a brief minute to give you an idea of the sort of thing that Thomas thought we should know about ourselves. Now, in the process of talking about antiquarianism and putting him into conversation with Jefferson, I'm going to suggest that the so-called historians of this period had very little to offer. History was a form of collective cheerleading for the regime. I'll talk a little bit about this later. History now, of course, now that people like me do it, is the most exalted enterprise possibly being involved in. It's basically useless, but we do serious research, and we can because of the resources right here, for which we're very grateful. But historians in the early modern period, I want to get this laid down first so you'll begin to appreciate what antiquarians brought to the table and why Isaiah Thomas, of all people, was the man to do it. Historians are people who tell stories about the succession of dynasties, about kings and queens. They get more sophisticated, or what they called philosophical, in the 18th century, so that it's not simply chronicles. It then, for men of letters, learned people who were deeply read in the classics, who would then tell the story of English history, David Hume, or for the early great historians of America, would tell the story of the Revolution, of all those events that we remember. It was the story told from on high, from a great philosophical perspective, with a long view of history. in the 18th century, the Scots, moral philosophers, were talking about the stages of historical development. So we're going beyond the succession of kings and queens. We're also talking about the stage of commercial, agricultural, and pastoral development. And so we have a big view of the world as a whole, a philosophical view. Now, we well-trained modern historians are trained not to philosophize, to look deep, not to look wide. And that, keep that in mind as we talk about what Isaiah Thomas has in mind, and I think you'll begin to see and share with me the surprise I felt when I saw what antiquarians were up to. I specifically have in mind William Bentley, Isaiah Thomas's good friend, Bentley from the polymath preacher from Salem, who was incredibly knowledgeable. If there was anything came into Massachusetts in a foreign language, send it to Bentley and he would translate it for you. Bentley fashioned himself as a kind of historian in our modern sense of the word, but an antiquarian in Isaiah Thomas's time. And Bentley said, you know what you want to know about the history of New England? I'll tell the story first. The history of New England. You think now the caricature of hanging witches is, well, we've gotten past that. Now we do sophisticated history of political protest in the 17th century or whatever it might be. That's just a random topic. That was an inside joke, forgive me. But Thomas says it is wrong to fixate on Cotton Mather. It's wrong to fixate on hanging witches in Salem. What we really need to know about the people of Massachusetts in the generations before the American Revolution, before us, we need to know what life was like. So that's a fairly simple, straightforward statement. But you know what he's saying when he says that? He's saying that all of us are important. It's the lives of everybody that matters. It's not those headline events that pass down to us through the history books. It's instead the texture, the structure of everyday life. And what was that like in New England? Now you think all those God-fearing Puritans who were obsessed with their spiritual state lived austere lives. Bentley invited us to join him in walking through a house in Salem, a house of a prominent merchant. And he said, guess what? I'll show you right here. And this is actually what he does. He takes us on a trip through a house for lessons that the material objects, the design of space, might give us about the way people lived. And he would say, you know, these people were very prosperous. These people didn't deny themselves luxuries. And you know what else is important? And this will sound a little obvious to you, disenchanted moderns, but what drives the world and what drove that world was the spread of commerce, the creation of wealth. That's what made their world go round. Yet we only see the surface. We only see all the things that have survived in the collective works of Cotton Mather. And I'm probably wrong about this, but that constitutes about 3/5 of everything ever published in his lifetime. Is that approximately true? I don't know if she's looking at me and disproving me. Probably wrong. You see these historians that just into precision. But the general idea is okay. But he says, commerce is important. I have something else to tell you. You think they're incredibly religious, we said that, right? Well, compare what they do and how they live with how people in early modern England, the England that they left, lived. How many saints' days were on the calendar? How much time was wasted in drunken revels on St. Monday? What had happened to daily life in New England was now, it was much more secular. Something you were surprised to hear, and Bentley's audience was surprised to hear right here, or not right there, at the then Antiquarian Society when he gave a talk in 1816 on this very subject. So he's telling us a couple of things. Most of the public events in New England in the 17th century were not associated with religious life. What really mattered was the generation of wealth. Even the existence of Harvard College, the center of learning, depended on the gifts of prominent merchants. I was stunned when I read this address, and this is maybe the beginning of my story about how I rediscovered antiquarianism. Stunned to find out how precocious this vision seemed, how amazingly out of time. How did he get to see the world in that way? Well, my short answer to you is because he was an antiquarian. Well, I promised to bring Jefferson back in, and that's why I'm wearing this tie tonight. And let me tell you about Jefferson, Thomas, and the Declaration of Independence. We're going to move back from 1812 to 1776, and then we'll return to 1812 to ask, what is on Thomas's mind? Why does this patriot, the patriot printer, think that this society could save the Republic? Why does the Republic need saving? Well, on July 14, 1776, right here in Worcester, Isaiah Thomas was the man who had the Declaration in hand and who read it out to a crowd just like you, but much rowdier. You were really excited. And at this moment, seemingly all across the continent, as they called it then, these 13 pathetic little coastal colonies, all across the continent, at virtually the same time, people were reading the same words. It was one great echo chamber. What an amazing moment it was. We know now that Jefferson, who signed my tie, was the man who wrote the Declaration of Independence. And we treasure and worship him, and he's been a good living to me over the years. Various members of my family and a lot of good friends. And I'll just say publicly now, for the last time, how grateful I am to Thomas Jefferson for that. But when the Declaration was read by Isaiah Thomas, it's significant that Thomas would read it, because Thomas, of course, was a printer. He was an artisan, came from a humble background, made his way up and down the coast to the Nova Scotia, South Carolina, eventually lands here in Worcester because he's running away from Boston. And that's what this place is the accident of the American Revolution in Boston. And the fact that Isaiah Thomas needed to be someplace safe. Well, if Isaiah Thomas and his fellow revolutionaries needed to be safe, of course, that's what all the things here need to be safe, which is why we, and I'm now being part of this collectivity, the AAS, because I identify, I am a member of the society, well, I get to do this, I get to say, we have spent an incredible amount of money on guaranteeing the safety of this building and all the precious things in it. This was an obsession. You don't know how much people worried about fire in the 18th century. Well, maybe you do in the early 19th century. It's the ubiquitous existential threat. It's always there. The disaster that's waiting to happen. And a disaster that's bound to happen in a time of war. Every American city that could be called a city, and these were actually overgrown villages in the time of the American Revolution, was occupied by the British, and they were all burned down. But the threat of fire was constant, and the possibility that Boston could burn was a live one. So you're safe here in Worcester, folks. Let them come. When we fight the American Revolution again, or reenact it, British invade us, we're safe here in Worcester. The point I want to make about the Declaration of Independence, though, is this. This is going to make this really clear. The ideas of the Declaration are, and you've read it, you've committed it to memory, they're self-evident, so I don't even have to tell you what the ideas are. You know what they are? Should we do a little pseudo-Socratic exchange here? No, thank you, my my good friends have stopped me. They have to do with, all men are created equal or by consent. Did Jefferson invent these ideas? They're self-evident. He tells us, in fact, in a late life letter, he explains to Henry Lee, I just was channeling the American people. He is the Shirley MacLaine of the 18th century. I never had these ideas. They just come through my mouth. Does that sound something like what happens to a text that goes through a printing press? He is just the medium for the message. The message has been circulating everywhere. What's the importance of having a document that puts it down? Not that it's teaching anybody anything, because they're already speaking those words. It's because they turn to each other, they understand that we're all hearing these words that are our words together. And we see in each other people who are saying the words and hearing them. It's a great circle that we're talking about. In fact, Thomas Jefferson and Isaiah Thomas are both part of this ensemble production, the circulation of an idea that's already out there. The ideas are self-evident, but here's the punchline. The technology for delivering them in this particular form at this moment is by no means self-evident. You couldn't have this kind of revolution, this kind of moment of simultaneous speaking and hearing without print. You think print is just one of those occupations that mechanics or artisans do? Well, everybody in the 18th century, including Thomas Jefferson, is in awe of the power of the press. And the power would not be there without printers who knew what they were doing, printers like Isaiah Thomas. So if the ideas are self-evident, their delivery isn't. Think about that for a minute. Contemplate it as Jefferson contemplated it, and Isaiah Thomas did too. And then look back from a later period to that moment of national beginning. It didn't begin because a great man came up with a nice way to say something original and new. It began because the people were mobilized. This is the first time in history that popular political mobilization, that feeling of a simultaneous uprising of the people, the feeling that a people mattered at all in the first place, this was something new under the sun. This is what astonished Thomas Jefferson and other commentators. Americans were astonished with themselves, because guess what? All men are not created equal. Don't want to break that to you too rudely. But the common sense of the thing, to borrow a phrase from Thomas Paine, is in fact, in the world that Jefferson and Isaiah Thomas lived in, all men are unequal. Some are born the owners of vast acres and many people. Guess which one? And some are born to make their own way in the world. But here is the significance of the Declaration and this moment that I want to focus on. Thomas Jefferson begins on high. If there's anything like a gentleman in America, it's Thomas Jefferson, who cultivates an elite persona, who cultivates a notion of rule, who's clear in his own mind about his enlightenment. Yet at this moment, Thomas Jefferson sublimates his identity in the identity of the people. He brings himself down, and he is the servant of the people. That inversion, that a great man becomes a servant, that's precisely what Jefferson had asked King George to be in 1774 when he wrote his famous incendiary pamphlet, The Summary View of the Rights of British America. He said, George, you want to save this empire? Understand that a king is a servant, and you must serve all your peoples across this great empire. Well, Jefferson comes down, but Isaiah Thomas, and he's not the only one, Benjamin Franklin, bigger name by far. Thomas was considered maybe the second most famous printer in early America. These are the people who rise up to the occasion. And the very idea of the American Revolution is that all of the people are capable of understanding their own rights and rising in their defense. That seems so obvious and banal to us, but it flies in the face of the world both of these men were born into. It's a moment, and I emphasize a moment, when each man can see himself as part of something bigger than himself, a shared enterprise, a moment in which the idea of equality became real. And it became real because Isaiah Thomas and Thomas Jefferson, metaphorically speaking, understood themselves to be equal to each other. And Jefferson might have gone on to say, not only are all men, meaning all citizens in this republic, equal, but those men who have useful knowledge, who make things, who invent things, who improve human welfare by actually doing something rather than lording it over and exploiting their fellow humans, these are the people who should be celebrated. This is the era among enlightened people like Thomas Jefferson, the era of the cult of the artisan. Useful knowledge, what they now call STEM, which is a tide, we must stem. I needed a break. So this is a moment in which we imagine a leveling up and a leveling down. We imagine equality as the fundamental premise of the foundation of the Republic. Now let's move ahead to 1812, the moment of the founding of the Antiquarian Society. I've teased you with the idea that American antiquarianism is not like Walter Scott's antiquarianism. I've suggested that history, as practiced by self-appointed gentlemen historians, men of learning in the early 19th century, late 18th century, is basically a continuation of the kind of talk, the kind of stories that were told by upholders of the old regime. There's nothing particularly new about it. Let me add this as a disciplinary mea culpa from one historian to a bunch of people who are really interested in history. We have been trying to make up for the fact that we historians that we have such tawdry beginnings. And those tawdry beginnings are in service of the creation of nation states. All history was written as national history in the 19th century, including my neighbor George Bancroft, right across Montville Road. It's all national history. It's all invented tradition. You experts have heard that phrase when we talk about how nations justify themselves. They have to have genealogies. They have to have pedigrees. They have to have a backstory, as we used to say on the radio. They have to have a legitimating narrative. So historians are myth makers. That's what they do. They invent speeches and put them in the mouths of famous people. They tell edifying stories, like Steve Bullock's Mason Weems inventing Washington for the 19th century. That's what historians thought had to be done. And any student of nationalism or the emergence of the nation state will talk about how historians play a vital role. But Isaiah Thomas says, that's not real history. That's not the history we in this republic need to remember. The history we need to remember is the history I participated in 1776, a history made possible by ordinary people, skilled people in this case, printers, but the ordinary people out there in the audience, they were the history makers. Why do we need to construct a narrative built on the doings of great men? Why do we need iconic figures? Why do we need heroes? Aren't we good enough ourselves? That's the question that he asks. And Thomas Jefferson, who joined the Antiquarian Society in 1814, would say, yes, that's exactly right. In fact, Jefferson would go on to say, in my career as a politician and a statesman, I did my best to keep the people engaged in their own government. Participation is the famous Jeffersonian idea. We need to participate. Citizens need to own their government. They need to own the Constitution. Because the earth belongs to the living. It belongs to you. And it's your government. It's your Constitution. And you need to own it. This is the way Jefferson deals with the problem. How do you sustain the spirit of 1776? Keep alive that moment when we all rallied around the idea of independence. How do we do it? And he would say, in his elaborate system of ward republics and federalism and robust democracy, strong democracy, that we need to keep the people out there reenacting the revolution every day of their lives. It's a tremendous demand, but it's another kind of demand in a different way that Isaiah Thomas makes. So that's my setup. How does Thomas imagine antiquarianism performing that great and urgent task of patriotic renewal? And my first answer, you will deduce from what I just said, is not to participate in myth-making, or the big lie, or what we call propaganda, a useful story. No, useful knowledge is authentic history. We need authentic history, not mythology. Because ultimately, the fate of the Republic depends on all of us. The same thing Jefferson had been saying. Why was this so compelling to Thomas in 1812? Thomas is an old man. Jim will correct me, but he's something like 63 years old at this time. And that was really old then. Now 71 is the new 63. So I know just how you felt. No, I got, that's right. We're synced. You know? I am Isaiah Thomas. I feel his pain. And you're going to feel my pain too. He's had an interesting career, and Jim has dramatized it. It's fascinating. Jim thinks he's not quite the son of a bitch. I think he is. After studying his business practices and the way he treats his partners, maybe he just didn't understand what he was doing to them. Is that what you were saying? I mean, I don't know if I say it, but I mean, Isaiah does need to do a little therapy first. Anyway, for Thomas Jefferson, 1776 was always the central point of his life. And the same thing I think you could say is true for Isaiah Thomas. Let's just go back 2 years to 1810 when he publishes his History of Printing in America, an amazing book which I will never pretend to read. I look at it. And I admire it, and I've picked it up many times. Though, actually, now it's only on the computer screen that I engage with it. But this is amazing, and it's amazing for a lot of reasons. I'll briefly tell you what's in it. I have looked through it the way historians do read books. And it is a biography of the entire printing trade in the world insofar as Thomas can reconstruct the biographies. I mean biographies of every single damn printer. This idea, it's a magnificent idea, and it is, I should say, as a typical antiquarian enterprise. Antiquaries want everything. They want everything. The good news about classical antiquities, there's not much everything, so you can make a reasonable, you can collect a lot. I'm joking a little bit, but and we're going to get into the plethora of antiquities in America and how we turned a deficit into an advantage. There's no there here, they used to say, about history in America. There's nothing, no history under our feet because we're a new nation. If there's going to be an American history, it's something we have to make, and they'll write it later. Wrong. This is not the way Isaiah Thomas understands it. All right. So he's 63 years old, and Massachusetts is on the verge, is involved in another war against Britain, the Second War of Independence, the War of 1812. Very important to keep in mind, that's that fear of fire, even to preserve the collections. There's a real threat that the British will, well, they burned Washington, didn't they? Boston was spared. And New Englanders were not necessarily enthusiastic about that war. I want you to have a collective moment of feeling guilty about the shortfall of patriotism here in New England, because you are all a bunch of, well, I'm going to fall into my southern accent after living many years in Virginia. I promised I wouldn't do this thing. You thought you might cut a separate deal with the British. You thought you might secede from the Union. You thought it was your Union, and you resented the fact that this great country was growing in different directions, namely westward into the South, and the real power of America was in that great continent, that hinterland, what Jefferson called those lands out there for thousands and thousands of generations. That's America. But you New Englanders are holding on to what you thought was your country because you thought you invented it in Lexington and Concord in 1775. Well, we're getting myself worked up, but what you need to know about Massachusetts at this time is it's highly partisan, deeply divided between the Federalist establishment, the old standing order in places like Connecticut, and the Democratic Republican insurgency grounded in disenchanted locals from outports and people from dissenting faiths. They're still going to establish churches in this part of the world, believe it or not. This, in a way, is a kind of a caricature, a theme park of Europe in America. Get over it. I never thought of that until today. It's a living museum of the way things used to be, and that's the great fear that people like Jefferson have, is that these people in Massachusetts want to return to monarchy. Admit it. You want to reestablish aristocracy, monarchy. You want to rejoin Britain. You want to recolonize yourself. I'm so excited about this theme, I could spend the rest of the evening talking about it, but I would miss the full thrust of the lecture, because I want you to know that Isaiah Thomas, though he was a soft, low Federalist, we found that out, there's no question about it, he made sure that his antiquarian society embraced all parties, embraced Unitarians, Trinitarians, Republicans, Federalists. Right here in Worcester, we were going to model a new kind of patriotism. The country might fall apart, that's what I wanted to say. And Thomas might end his days, he might die in the wreckage of the great nation he thought he'd played a role in founding. Thomas, in other words, like Thomas Jefferson, is worried about the memory people will have of him and of the moment that he had participated in. The Patriot of 1812 had been a patriot in 1776. What does the Patriot in 1812 have to do? Well, this is the antiquarian enterprise, and this is what Isaiah Thomas's answer to that great question is. We need to, and this is like a mantra, we can repeat it collectively as they do in showings of the Rocky Horror Picture Show, we need to collect, preserve, remember, connect. We need to forge attachments with each other in the patriotic act of collecting the evidence of the past as it is received, as the water recedes when the waves crest and the water falls back, and all the evidence might be lost. Just a brief diversion here to give you some sense of the imminent sense of loss that is foundational to Isaiah Thomas's patriotism. The loss, what do lose? Well, Jefferson would have said, the spirit of 1776. Thomas would say, no, what we might lose, if we're not careful, is the evidence of who we were, the evidence of what imprint previous generations made on this land and on us. It might all be lost. And this gets to the central point of my lecture. The great threat to the Republic, the existential threat to the Republic, is not British-inspired conflagration. It's not war. The great danger, the threat to the Republic, is that we forget, that our memories are erased. Republics are famous, one of the antiquaries told his fellow antiquarians. Republics are famous for their ingratitude. They think they invented themselves. They think they are capable of governing themselves. They think they did it all by themselves. They don't know how they got to be where they were. Remember Bentley's analysis of Puritan society in the 17th century? All of that is in aid of helping you understand how you might have gotten to be who you were, well, in 1776, or now in 1816 when you gave that address. Understanding the past is critical to understanding who you are in the present. Jefferson had a way of talking about this when he wrote his famous letter to James Madison in 1789, "The Earth Belongs to the Living." And in that letter, when he talks about the living generation, you think, well, Jefferson is just some kind of flaming libertarian. He wants everyone who's alive now to wine, women, and song, party down, because it's your moment. No. That's not his lesson. His lesson is Isaiah Thomas's lesson. You must know that you own this earth now in usufruct, in stewardship for the next generation. It's that intergenerational understanding. And you must pass it on to the next generation. And the next generation, grateful, remember the centrality of that charge of ingratitude, grateful for the great gift of this land, we will cherish it and pass it on to the next generation. This is the immortality of the nation. My two Thomases agree on this. They use different language to talk about. Thomas is focused on the things we know or should know but may forget. This place, the Antiquarian Society, is a place that doesn't allow us to forget. It demands from us, as we use it, to honor every name recorded in it. This idea of having names really important. Everybody has one. In the old histories of the old regime, only a few names matter, because only a few names of great people signify anything. Most people don't even get to have a surname in the early modern period, but you have all got a name. And what does your surname do for you? It connects you to your parents. It connects you to the previous generation. You pass on a name, and that is another connection. I have proclaimed you an independent nation, the living generation. And Jefferson actually says this. Every generation is, with respect to every other generation, like an independent nation. Does that mean they go to war? No. It means that they respect each other's integrity, and they understand their responsibilities and duties. And what binds the generations together is love. It's the love that is based on the gratitude we have for what we have been given. You might say it's a secularized version of the kind of love of God that a faithful people would render in their religious observances. But it amounts to the same thing. There is something beyond us. I want to talk about that name business for just a bit. because antiquarians in America began with the idea that they were not going to explore the classical world and compete with learned and elite people in Europe in the scale of their collections so that they could take the grand trip to Rome and come back with some fragment of some stupid temple and claim themselves connected with a great tradition. Because our antiquities begin with yesterday's paper. And I say that advisedly here at the Antiquarian because that is one of the markers of the ambition, the scale of Isaiah Thomas's vision. Everything must be collected. Not just the New York Times for the day you were born, which you could buy for $10.95. No, every issue of every year of every newspaper ever printed, starting today. Instant antiquities. Everything you thought was modern and new will be an antiquity. And one of the reasons it will be rare is because you wasteful, forgetful people are throwing away your papers. I said, are you kidding me? This is waste. This is trash. What isn't trash in America, I ask you? There's a great interest in ancient America and the antiquities of the peoples who preceded European settlers. And this is the place where that interest is fostered. But can we collect those antiquities? Isaiah gets a nice letter from one of his admirers that says, I love your organization. You should have started it 2 centuries ago. Because you're missing out on all the cool stuff. The great enemy of antiquities, well, on the one hand, for the print sources I've been talking about, it's the fact that there's so much of it, it's worthless in marketplace terms. Who needs it? That's why I got rid of all my books. Oh, say that out loud. I gave them to worthy people so they could start new libraries and collecting on their own, like Johnny Appleseed spreading libraries. We throw away print because we take it for granted. We just think it spontaneously erupts and it will somehow preserve it. There's so many copies. And this is the paradox of book collecting. So many copies, but the things you think are least worth keeping are those things that become most rare and precious. Am I right? I'm looking to my authority figures. Yeah, makes sense, doesn't it? So what if you said to yourself, everything that comes from the press is indicative of what's happening every day in this great country, in this particular place. Let's keep it. Let's keep everything in our cabinet of curiosities. Bring it on. Whatever you got. A piece of an old church out there in Western Massachusetts when so-and-so was the preacher. I'm just quoting from some of the letters I've read. This is really exciting. Yeah. Send it in to us. Anything. Coins, you see the obvious interest in that. Rocks, I got some rocks for you. Okay. There is nothing that is irrelevant if you want to do total history. You want to do everything. You need to know everything. You need all the evidence. In all that evidence, we live. And here, this is going to be a really profound insight that I have to share with you. It's so profound, I'm not sure I fully understand it myself. British writer L.P. Hartley said once that the past is a foreign country. You heard that phrase before. You want to go there, you need a translator. You need a passport. You need to carry a lot of luggage with you. Because it's not going to be a place you begin to understand if you're unequipped to do so. That's what the good, authentic historian, antiquarian, does, is collect everything that can be known so that when we encounter that time, when we imagine ourselves in the company of Hugh Peter or any 17th century Puritan, we don't say, oh my God, it's a famous person. We see instead, I see how this guy functioned in his own time and place. As we now tritely say, we see him as a human being. Easier said than done through the disturbing lenses of history, through the myth-making of our conventional narratives and understanding. Some people are really important, most people are not. But Bentley says, everybody is important, one. And two, we need to encounter them immediately and simply. The better our understanding of the world in which our subjects lived, the better our ability to encounter them in a simple, direct, almost unmediated way. When we surround ourselves with all the evidence, the objects, the texts, we have a true and authentic understanding. I want to say one thing about names, and then I think I'm sensing that I need to bring this to what those psychologists call closure, because we're experiencing this traumatic moment together. Is going on. I hate it when I have to stop lecturing. It's really kind of hurtful. I want to talk about names for just a minute. I mentioned the antiquities of Ohio, the mounds, ancient America. They talk about ancient America all the time. One of the things that some of the antiquarian writers say is, you know that whole idea of the transit of civilization beginning? Somewhere in the Mediterranean, this is pre-evolutionary, we're not talking about the origins of mankind quite, but most of the antiquarians are good Bible believers, so they think history doesn't go back that far. And they suggest, however, that maybe all those European writers have got it backwards, and it all began here. And that all the stuff about going across the Bering Strait, ooh, I got a counter thesis for you. It's the other way. Well, you can see some of this is pretty lame, and it's all about how wonderful we are. But it's one way of saying, and this is the key point, the new world is in fact an old world. And that distinction, which you think Americans glory in, that they're new and Europeans are old, well, only in the immediate sense of they're stuck with monarchy and they haven't seen themselves evident. Truths they haven't operated on them yet, and we have. All right. But there's something pathetic about what we do discover in ancient America. And have any of you ever been in Marietta? Have you seen the mounds? Well, they're even more impressive in Cahokia. There is, in the eyes of the first beholders, settler beholders, English settler beholders, American settler beholders, this was a lost civilization. This is something amazing. And it needs to be explained that maybe we need to rethink the history of the great native civilizations in Mesoamerica. Maybe they began in Illinois, in Ohio. But here's the pathetic thing. We know these monuments, these mounds, were built to honor some great man or event, something. There's some specificity. People of the time of the building of these monuments knew what they stood for and what they said. They were legible. You could read them. Now you can't. You can't read them. You can speculate about them. You can imagine it must have been for this or that. Oh, this is where they killed people. Oh, no, this is where they played games. This is the kind of theorizing they're doing. They understand it's theorizing. And the deep sadness of it all is that those people tried to remember. They inscribed their messages on the land and their monuments and their landscape, but now they're indecipherable. We can't read them. Their names are lost. They make the direct connection between the lost names of a lost civilization and the names we claim for ourselves in the first modern civilization, the first modern state to make itself a self-governing nation. Our names are precious. They must be remembered. In this way, the Maya Lin Memorial of Vietnam in Washington is so powerful. And while the names in the new Montgomery lynching are so powerful. Names evoke lives. And what we need to do is to remember the lives of those who came before us so that we can take that knowledge with us and leave that knowledge to succeeding generations. This is why antiquarianism, collecting the people's history, this is foundational. You can't write the people's history without the kind of materials collected here. It's only in the modern period, as historians have shaken off the idea that they're myth makers for the nation, that these materials have become foundational to new kinds of history. I was going to say Isaiah Thomas couldn't imagine, but I take that back, because I think people like William Henry were imagining a kind of history that encompassed everybody. It wasn't a romantic, sentimental history. But they would tell us about the rise of capitalism, how wealth generated power. But it was an authentic history, an expression antiquaries use, an authentic history that could enable us to see our way forward. And why was it important? I said before, this is a period in which the American experiment and Republican government seems to be on the brink of failure. This is a moment, one of many moments, before the great moment of the American Civil War, when the Union seems to be at risk. When Americans forget, you might say, who they are. They forget what happened in 1776 and in many moments thereafter when Americans did reenact their sense of citizenship, equality, connection, and attachment, collecting, preserving, remembering, connecting. We tend to forget. Why? It's because Republicans are so busy with their own business. They're not thinking about legacies. They're not thinking about what they leave. If they think about the next generation, they're thinking exclusively about their own children, as if they were starting little dynasties of their own. What's lost is the idea of a generation, every generation, all of us, from different places, owning different amounts of money, even speaking different languages. But that civic equality and identity is critical and has to be cherished. Isaiah Thomas didn't resent the fact that the world was getting bigger, the American world was getting bigger. In fact, the whole goal of the antiquarian society at a time of intersectional conflict and potential collapse of the Union was, let's get antiquaries everywhere. Let's collect antiquaries who will collect. It's the meta collection of collectors. This is what's going to make America great, because what we're collecting is for the patriotic purpose of reminding ourselves and those who follow in our footsteps of where we have been and who we are. Cherish that history, my fellow antiquarians. Come here to the Antiquarian Society. Use these materials. Refresh your sense of your own identity as an American. This is American antiquarianism. Seems a lot like authentic, real, modern-day historical practice. And isn't it wonderful that, not knowing exactly why they were doing it, the people who kept this institution alive, more for local patriotic reasons, more because it became a site for dwelling on the wonders of New England civilization and the Mather collection and so forth. That was a reference for Meredith back there. In a way, antiquarianism achieved great success, but it was a kind of latent success that depended on future generations to make good on the promise extended by Thomas and his fellow antiquaries. A shout out to Tom Knowles, who's doing an edition of Bentley's diary. This is one of the great documents published, I think, in late 19th century, 1874 or something, actually didn't correct me. This document was edited to suit the tastes of New Englanders in the era of the so-called colonial revival, when they're increasingly worried about all those people from other places who are coming to work in the mills of New England, Irish, French Canadians, Italians. And there was a nativist response against this, and part of the expression was to revive colonial history, to start building houses in the colonial modes so that we have museums that would teach people to be just like us, wasps. And so in the edition that was published in 1874, everything that Bentley has to say about anything beyond Salem has been cut out. And that's what Tom is restoring in his edition. That restoration of the full text is the full text that's always been here, ready for you to read. And think this as you read here, as you absorb this knowledge, as things come alive for you, that you are living the fulfillment of Isaiah Thomas's vision. And that vision is that you, the person who comes here, the person who reads, the person who goes away with the knowledge of what she or he read, is reaffirming a sense of citizenship, of the people's democratic history, of our history. Everything must be known. The lives of all printers must be restored. Printers stand in for everybody. Be a part of that. Save our country.